Hello everyone. So this is about introduction to data analysis with Python. I'm Divya Thakur, the lead instructor at Code Heroku. We at Code Heroku are trying to make world-class computer science and education accessible to millions of students in developing countries like ours, India. In today's session, we'll be going over why data analysis? Why are we doing data analysis in today's era? Why is it important? We'll be seeing many kinds of tools and libraries that are available for this kind of data analysis. And lastly, we'll be having a hands-on exercise on actually how to perform data analysis on a given data set. So let me address the question, why data analysis? Can anyone tell me why data is such a buzzword in 21st century? So 90% of the world data has been created in the last 2 years alone. And this is a fact that was quoted by Forbes. So for data scientists across India that have knowledge of data analysis coupled with knowledge of machine learning and deep learning algorithms can easily earn 12 lakh per annum in Mumbai, 10 lakh in Bangalore, and around 9 lakh in metro cities like Delhi, Pune, Chennai, Hyderabad, and Kolkata. So let's move on to data analysis tools being used. So traditionally, there was one tool which is still being used today, which is Excel. It can do filters. It can do any kinds of functions upon them, like take out mean, median, and also graph them up. But it cannot handle large amounts of data, for example, of gigabytes or terabytes that is being produced today. So comes into picture Jupyter Notebooks, which are a form of literate programming. They enhance this via Python, R, or Julia. And you can see your results as soon as you type in, you can see your results in the notebook. So we'll see how Jupyter Notebooks help. So why use a programming language when a manual tool like Excel is available to us? That's because it enables us to work on a large data sets. And it increases reproducibility. So for example, if you have data upon world population till 2010, and you are accessing the same data in 2018, you will have to download it into Excel and perform the same data cleaning things that you had done before. But in Jupyter, you just have to change the name of the data set that you're importing. All other things can remain the same. So programming language also reduces the latency that we might encounter while cleaning, while manipulating, or while visualizing the data, which is more in case of Excel. Also, it's easier to reference external data sources. What if your data set is there in TXT format? Your Excel cannot do any kind of task upon it. What if your data is present in the web in a tabular form? Python can actually do web scraping upon it and save the tabular data in Pandas is a data frame, but this cannot be done in Excel. So about the Python packages that we'll be using today. So first one is NumPy. So in Python, there are data structures like list, sets, dictionaries, but these do not allow array manipulation or linear algebra computations. And the mathematical operations performed on the list are not that fast. So NumPy is a library, although written for Python, but based on C++, it allows fast mathematical computations and it allows one to create arrays. So you can do matrix multiplication. So another Python package that we'll be using today is Pandas. Pandas takes in a 2D data, which is composed of rows and columns similar to the data that is used in Excel. So this whole stuff is known as a data frame in Pandas, and the values in each column are known as series. So one whole column makes series of data in Pandas. So let's explore today's data set. So today's data set is comprised of 227 countries. So we'll be having features of those countries with the region in which they are located, their population, their area, their GDP, the climate in which they are. So climate ranges are from 1 to 5, ranging from subtropical, tropical, and these kind of climate zones. and then birth rate, death rate, infant mortality. So all of these features of each country are listed in our data set, and we can be performing data analysis on them. So are we all ready for a hands-on exercise? So I'm sharing this link with you all, and open the folder in which you're downloading your zip file. And because I'm on Windows, you can just go here and do extract all, because it's a zip file, and it opens up. So please download it. So can anyone tell me what's the full form of CSV? Exactly. That's right, Manan. And what about TSV? So TSV is tab-separated values, that is comprising of four spaces. Each value is separated by four spaces. Okay, so has everyone downloaded and extracted the folder? Now go to your start menu and type in Anaconda. I believe everyone has Anaconda Navigator installed onto their system so that we can access Jupyter Notebooks. Then click on Anaconda Navigator and let it open up for you. So can you all see Anaconda Navigator onto your system? Can you all see the screen on your system? Okay, moving ahead, I'll just be clicking on this launch button. And open up the path where I have just saved my extracted folder. You need to go into your Anaconda Navigator and click on that launch button, which will take you to this path over here. See, we have this countries of the world CSV. So let me open this up. As you can see, all these values are separated by commas. So these are string values and each of them is separated with commas. And we have this starter notebook for you all that we'll be doing our code on today. I have provided some of the important things to you, and some we'll be performing hands-on. And this is the complete solution notebook. So these are the modules that we'll be working on, as I told you earlier. So import pandas, import NumPy, and then for visualization, import matplotlib, and from matplotlib, import pyplot. So I've written it as import matplotlib.pyplot, and import seaborn again for visualization. And then I have given them an alias as PD, as NP, as PLT, as SNS. So these are the famous aliases, because we cannot again, time and again, write seaborn wholesomely or matplotlib.pyplot again and again, because we have to use these modules and the functions that it carries. Has everyone understood what I have imported and why? And why I have given them an alias? And now I have also written person matplotlib inline. So this just ensures that whatever figure that we are plotting is being drawn in the cell itself. So what about cell? So this gray area is a cell. Each gray area is a cell. So what does a cell do? It lets you, suppose, let me try over here. It lets you type in your code. So if it's print, and I write over here 3 + 5, and then press Control Enter or Shift Enter. It's Control Enter for running the cell or Shift Enter for running the cell. Alternatively, you can click over here, Run button, and run this cell also. So let me change the value, and now I'll be using Control Enter, and again I'll be using Shift Enter. So guys, if you have to just run the cell and be present on that same cell, use Control Enter. But if you have to run the cell and go move on to the next one, please press Shift and Enter. So I would like you all to run this particular cell. I'm using Shift and Enter to run this, just to ensure that I've imported my modules. And we have some tasks for today. The first one being import the data set. So the data set that we just saw now, comma separated values, the name of it is countries of the world dot CSV. So just do a control C from here, copy this, or alternatively, this is selected. So go and just do copy. Okay, just copy the name of your data set. Come over to your starter notebook and we'll be writing a function. I have created a variable to store my data frame, to store the rows and columns of the huge data that we are importing. And I'm writing td.read_CSV, and this is a function. And function always comes with parentheses. And parentheses always require some parameters. So this time our parameters are the name of our data set, because it's stored in the same folder. I'll just do double quotes, or single quotes, and paste in the value that you have copied. That is the name of our data set. And please run this cell. This will load your entire data set into the variable world. Has everyone understood how we have imported our data set? Okay, someone is getting an error, which is no module named matplotlib. Okay, Kunal, so matplotlib must not be there in your kernel by default. So you might have to go to anaconda prompt, which is this. Pardon me. Just go to anaconda prompt and do a pip install matplotlib and press enter. Since mine is already installed, I'm not pressing enter. And after you have done that, please come to this cell and run it. So let's move on. First, let's check what the type of a variable is. If it's data frame, then we have rightly imported our data set. So for that, I'm just typing type. It's again a function and it will take in a variable world and run this cell. So you can see something like this, pandas.core.frame.dataframe. And if you can see it, you have rightly imported your data set. Congratulations. So now we'll do some manipulation on data set. Okay, now my data set has been imported, but how does it look like? How many rows are there? How many columns are there? What are the data types of each row, of each column? Isn't there a curiosity about this? Because curiosity is important to have for a data analyst. So anyone can go into Google and tell me what attribute or function will give me the result of number of rows and columns in our data set. Yes, Nikhil, you have raised your hand. What's the matter? Yeah, it's shape. So people who are not familiar with pandas just can go into Google and type in pandas, number of rows or number of columns as your keyword, and take yourself to the documentation. It will give you a large number of attributes. So the right answer is shape. Yeah, world.shape. Right. So we'll just do a world.shape, and I expect my number of rows to be 227, equivalent to the number of countries we have. So press in. So yes, we have 227 rows and 20 columns, that is 20 features of each country. Seems interesting. Not df.shape, because and not a parenthesis, because shape is an attribute. So guys, what's the difference between an attribute and a method or function? Why does this shape does not have parentheses? It's not about arguments or parameters, but attributes are like variables that are written inside a class. So it's a property of the object or the data member of the class, while a function is the operation or the activity that this particular object can perform. So attribute is a variable which doesn't need any argument, but functions do because they are going to perform operations. So let's move on to a third subtask, which is view the first 5 and the first 10 rows. So can anyone tell me the function or attribute for this? Exactly. So it's world.head, and this time we are having parentheses because it's a function or a method. And this gives you first 5 rows by default. What if you have to view first 10? Either you can do n equals to 10 or simply write 10 over here. Yeah. Everyone got it right. What about the last 5 and the last 10 rows? What's the function for that? Everyone seems to be equipped with these functions already. It's good. So it's tail, but tail is not an attribute, so it requires a parenthesis. And by default, it's going to give the last 5 rows, and 10 is going to give you the last 10 rows. Moving ahead, what about unique elements? So when I have done this head and tail, so let me see the kind of values that they are in our data set. So I can see lots of string values with these 3 columns. Then I can see kind of int values. I can see float values, but unfortunately there is a comma between them. So let's dive into this well with just 2 rows. So can everyone see commas in between numbers, which is not desirable because either you can have no comma or you can have a decimal point over here. So each column is having such anomaly. But here in climate, I can see int values. And these int values are getting repeated. So 2 is being repeated for like 7 times over here in the last 10 rows. 1 is getting repeated for 2 times. So I'm just curious to know how many unique elements are there in the column climate. So actually how many values are there that are getting repeated again and again? So climate my column, I've grabbed like this, just like we do with indices of list or indices of tuples or sets. So I'll just run it. And it will return me an array of list. So can you all see this NaN being repeated in our column? What does NaN stand for? Anyone? Yeah, not a number, Sanjay. So if you have misplaced some value or there is a special character, so your dataset will treat it as NaN. So we have to remove these commas from our dataset, replace them with a decimal. And also we have to fill all these NaN values with something. So this is our part of data cleaning. So we have seen this in data manipulation itself. Now let's view the number of unique elements. So how many such numbers are there? So for that, simply this time I don't want a list. I just want a number of unique values that are getting repeated. The number of unique values. So that it's just n unique. And it's again a function that takes in a parenthesis but no parameter. The values are 6. And again, info about the column names. Now I want 3 things at once. I want column names that are there in my data set, each of their data type, and whether they have null values or non-null values, and what is the number of these non-null values. Why should it be? It can be region also, because region is also getting repeated, I understand. But I have taken climate just to show this, because 2 is being repeated quite many times. Yeah, it's info. Describe is for summary stats, Bandi. So world.info is giving you the names of all your columns as well as these non-null values. So 227 here. So all my countries are having names, but literacy is having some null values because the total number of non-null values are just 209. And same goes for death rate, 223, 224, 205, and so on. So we have quite a many null values. Now, I want to analyze my data set with respect to 5-point summary. That is, I want to see what its mean is. Where are my first 25% of data lying? Where is my 50% of data lying? 75% of data lying at which data point? And what are the minimum and maximum values? So I want a 5-point summary of my data. So for that, the function is volt.describe. So these are known as summary stats. Yeah, so I've gotten three columns and their count, their mean, the standard deviation, minimum, the first interquartile range, the second one, that is also known as median, the third one, and the maximum value. But can anyone now tell me why am I getting just three columns in this? Rather, I'm having 20 columns in my info. So these are numerical columns. Yeah, these are the ones which are int and float, and the other ones are having object. So actually the data type is string, but here it's showing object. So why is that so? Why does pandas show it as object, not as string? A complex question though, but if anyone can answer, I'll be more than happy. Yeah, so these three columns are numerical. They are having floater int values, but other columns are object type. So data frame is actually a data structure, Prince. But these columns are having data types as object. Yeah, every column is a series. No, actually, pandas does not copy the strings explicitly. It rather creates a pointer to that string. And that's why it treats it as an object, because it's having the pointer stored, not the string stored in its data frame. So it's some deep topic, but this is why. But you can all treat it as strings. We are treating it as strings. So let's move on to data cleaning. We observed some of the anomalies in a data set, namely comma values, and we want them to get. So anyone who hasn't, please go through your solution notebook. Try it out yourself and ask me any questions that you have. I'm giving you a break of 2 minutes. Yeah, so Gopal Krishnan is asking how to find the attribute and function for the module. So just go in to Google and type in attributes and functions and you'll get a list of them in the documentation. Just a minute, we are good to go, yeah. So just go in here and you'll get the list of it. And you can try it on your own. So let's move ahead to data cleaning. So now moving on to data cleaning, which is a task number 3. The first one was importing the data set. The second one was manipulating it, satisfying a curiosity buts of what is inside the data. Now we'll be performing 2 subtasks simultaneously. The first one being removing the commas in our column with dot, but still that will be an object and not a float data type. So the second step is converting all these objects into float types. Can you do a world.columns for me? Exactly, Ravi. It gives you the list of columns. So now pop density per square miles is having comma. Coastline is also having comma. And going climate is not having a comma, but it's still having string values. And till service, we are having commas. So everyone, even with me, that from starting from pop density per square miles, we have commas in our column values. Yeah. So if I go on and removing comma from each of the column, that will become tedious because now I have how many? If I exclude these 1, 2, 3, and 4, so I'm having 16 columns, and upon 16 of each, I'll have to perform removing commas individually. So isn't that a repetitive task? And how are repetitive tasks managed in programming languages? Yeah, by use of loops. So you can either do a while or a for loop. So I've used for over here. So I have done this world.columns. And I'm grabbing all of these column names starting from pop density till service. Did a quick control C and have pasted it over here. Although I've given it in your starter code, I just want to show you all how I came about to this list that I have in front of me. So I've grabbed all the columns whose commas I want to change into dots and whom I want to convert into floats. So I'll be running a for loop. I'm grabbing each element from this list. So I'm just saying for column in my list whose name is str underscore columns. And be sure to provide indentation, that is four spaces, otherwise your loop will not work. And we'll be doing world column. And be sure to write str so that your value gets converted into string first, and then you are applying this method, which is only valid for a string. So replace within single quotes, I'm saying replace a comma, because that's a string literal, with a dot, again in single commas or single inverted commas or double inverted commas. So everyone got how I ran this for loop on str underscore columns and applied this function of replacing comma with a dot. Yeah, but this will just change it temporarily. It will not store what operation we are performing. So let's store it somewhere. So we'll store this result in the column name that we have. So we are replacing all the column values with this operation that we are performing on the column values. And lastly, we want to change each column value into a float, because even after removing a comma, it's still gonna remain an object. So to each of the column value, so now, anyone can tell me what the function should I write over here? If you are not seeing the solution template, I could have just written comma in place equals to true, and it would have worked. But I'm coming to that in the later section, so I just skipped it over here. So it's pd.toNumeric. So this toNumeric function, why is it having a prefix of pd and not world? This is an OOP related concept, if anyone can answer. So my toNumeric function has been defined within the class and not as an object method. Yeah, it's a pandas function and not the function of the object that pandas is creating. Yeah, so. So I'll just be converting pd.toNumeric world column. I should have written columns over here. That's my list name. So everyone, please make sure that each of the column that you're browsing on, you're pressing shift and enter to run it, if you're coming on to the next one again. If you're getting errors like me, please rerun the whole notebook again. And let's check if all of our commas have been replaced with dots and if our values have converted themselves from object to floats. So how can I check that all my commas have been replaced with a dot? How can I check? I can check it visibly. There's no other method. So I'll just have to do a head, and I'm taking just one row at a time. Yeah. So indeed, I have all my values now having a dot instead of commas. And now since I want to see what the D types of each column is, I can either run world.dtypes, the attribute, and it's just gonna be showing me these data types of each column, or you can do an info. You can get all the three information at once. So has everyone tried this? So let's do our third subtask in data cleaning, which is filling in the missing values, that is the none values. So can anyone give me two functions of examining that what are the number of null values in each column? Because Gopal Krishnan, we wanted it to convert itself into a float that so that we can do data analysis on it. Because we want numerical data, right? And a comma wouldn't have helped there. Yeah. So is null is the method, and is none will also work. So is null will return me the whole of the data frame with false and true values. So if the values are present, it will show me false. I repeat again, if the values are present, if there is a number, if there is a string, so that will show me false. But if there is no value, neither string nor float nor int, it will show me true, as you can see here. So there are true values as well, over here as well. So this didn't help me much. It's just giving me an overview of my whole data set all over again. I'm interested in computing the count. So I'll just do a sum, that is grab all those null values and give me a sum of those null values present in each of my columns. So now I can see literacy having the highest number of null values, 18. Sorry, climate is having the highest number of null values is 22, followed by literacy, followed by industry, and agriculture and service. So I can see that from net migration till service, I'm having null values. So now what to do these with these null values? Should they be removed or should they be replaced? What do you all think? Yeah, they should be replaced, because if we remove, we might have to remove the whole row, which is not desirable. So if you are adhering to replacing these null values, so we'll be replacing it either with mean or median. So mean and median to be used for numerical data types and mode to be used for categorical data types. So numerical is something which we can count either discretely like 1, 2, 3 or continuously. Categorical means that we can only have string types of data. And say if I have a list and this list is having these values, so I'm also having a NaN, 4 and a 5. So what all do you think will go into NaN in place of NaN? If you computed mean, so guys, tell me what the mean is, what the formula of mean is. Yeah, sum of all the entries upon number of entries. So here it's 1 plus 2. We are not counting NaN because we cannot. 4 plus 5. So this will give you 3 or 3.0. What if I had a list with these values, 1, 2, and NaN? I'm having 4, but now I'm having an extremely bigger value, which is 100. So what will its mean be? Since we are talking of replacing null values with some value, because removing them will remove the entire row. So we have decided to replace null values with something. Now we are thinking about replacing it with what? So we have got the point that we'll be using mode for categorical values, but we are having numerical values here. So we'll either be replacing the null values with mean or mode, but what to use? Should we use mean or should we use mode? Should we use median? So this is what we are having a thought about. And if you computed median, guys, for both of these lists, what that shall be? When the distribution is skewed, it's good to replace it with median. If the distribution is normal, it's good to replace it with mean. So if you have your values rightly distributed over your quartile ranges, then it's mean. If you have left or right skewed values, it's median. So yeah, for both of these, median is 3. So it's good that we replace our null values with median. Everyone agrees with me on this? So I have this for you as an example that I've computed both the means and the medians, and median values are same for these kind of lists. So I will now be plotting a histogram. So histogram is a plot that it gives you the distribution of numerical data of a single variable. So people, now you're having the template with you. What's the code for this? World.hist, and what should I write here? Is anything needed? So it has rightly given me all of these histograms, but they are not visible. Also, this array that Matplotlib is generating. So either you can place in a semicolon over here to remove this, or simply write in plt.show with a parenthesis. So now these subplots are clubbed. So you can quickly do a fix size equals to, and it's important that you give your length and width in a tuple format, otherwise it won't work. So I'm just giving a length of 10 and a height of 5 to each of my subplots. And they are about visible. So everyone please reach here and let me know. So what we'll be doing is, we have noticed that from net migration up to service, we are having null values. So I've grabbed all of these columns. I've given it into the starter template from net migration till service. And again, I'll be going over a for loop. So I'm grabbing each of these elements and doing a quick column in fill columns. You know the drill. So this time the function is fill NA, and I'm just doing median over here. So what should come in fill NA? What values can come here? Either you can do np.median. So everyone with me till here. So let's move on to something else. Again, a subtask in data cleaning, which is duplicate values, if any, because if there are any rows that have been duplicated, but I believe we have 227 countries and none of the row has been duplicated. I'll just check if any of my rows have duplicated values. So for that, the function is duplicated. And again, it's going to be giving me a whole lot of my data frame. So I'll just do a sum and see that indeed it's a zero. I don't know what other feature is of a country. I don't know what to do with this other or its values. I'm just going to be running a world dot drop. So I'm just grabbing this other, which is my column name. I'm giving it an axis of one. Column values are represented by the axis one, and for rows it's zero, right, Jatish? And I can do a world equals to here. My whole data frame equals to this. Or I can just go in here and do in place equals to true. I'd already dropped that column, and that's why it wasn't able to find other when I ran it a second time. So this is the magic of Jupyter. It works as a kernel, but it doesn't lose your data. It rather stores it in the notebook. If I went back and run this again, it won't be finding other, and it's going to be giving you an error. Dropping columns because I don't want to perform anything on it. So if after this cleaning, if you want to import your cleaned data set, so you can just go in and type pd.to_csv and give it a name, suppose countries_cleaned.csv. And this is going to be generating indices for you of its own. So be sure you write index equals to false, so the world dot. So now if you went back to your folder, you can see countries cleaned.csv over here. The clean data set is with you now. The same thing that you were performing in Excel, going over manually, you were getting the clean data set, but now you have a copy of the unclean data set and also the clean data set. So now let's move on to data visualization. And in here, I have a univariate plotting, bivariate plotting, and lastly, multivariate plotting. So what do I mean by univariate plotting, if anyone can tell that? Index equals to false, because if I hadn't done that, see over here, my countries cleaned does not have explicit indices. It will take in indices as 0, 1, 2, 3 for the rows as it was taking earlier. But if I don't do this, it will generate indices of its own. So rather you'll be having two indices, 0, 0, 0, 1, kind of like that. You don't want that. Getting me, Ankit? Okay. So people, what do you mean by univariate plotting? Yeah, single variable plotting. So that can be a numerical column or even a categorical column. So you can go over here and tell me how pandas will plot a box plot for the birth rate column. You can also do the same using matplotlib and seaborn, But I've shown you with respect to pandas because world.boxplot takes in the data frame world and the pandas is doing the thing for you. So now you have to give column equals to just the way we were giving n equals to 10 in our head. So you have to write column equals to birth rate. And please be sure that you write all of these dimensions in a tuple. And again, to remove this, I'll be putting a semicolon over here. So this green value over here represents mean. This is the minimum, this whisker, and that whisker is maximum. If you had any outliers, that will be shown as... So this box over here has all my Q1, Q2, and Q3 ranges. So everyone understood what this vertical box plot represents. So now we'll be doing bivariate plotting again with a box plot. So box plots can be used to do univariate as well as bivariate plotting. So if the question is how much land is arable in each climate, so you are going over arable column, how much land is arable. So arable will show up on the y-axis. So even if I asked how highest value of arable land, lowest value of arable land, here I'm asking how much land is arable. So y-axis always has that column which we are looking the values for. And by, so climate will go to x axis. Everyone understood what will go on y and what will go on x. So I want to do computations on arable column. So computations go to y axis, while in each climate or in each country that will go to my x axis. Okay. Now, do you get it, Reshma and Bandi? Yeah. So even here, so we'll just do world.boxplot and take in column equals to, again, in inverted commas, I'll write in. What should I write here? Yeah, Reshma. That's right. But climate here is not categorical. It's a float value, if you remember. That's why I said if we are doing computations on climate, that will go on y-axis. Here we are doing computations on arable, so that will go on y-axis. So I'll just type in column equals to arable and by equals to climate. To again, bivariate plotting with bar plot. So bar plots exclusively take in categorical values on the x-axis. So your x-axis should have a categorical value, which is not true in the case of box plot. And y-axis should be a numerical value. So this is the condition that bar plots, going by its name, produces bars, which are equivalent in heights or lengths to the values they represent. Let's plot a bar plot. This time, I'm not using the inbuilt plots that... Pandas uses, because I've also imported two libraries, which is matplotlib that I'm using for plt.show and stuff, but I've not used seaborn yet. So I'll just do sns.barplot. And because I'm specifying barplot on SNS, so I need a data variable to go in. And a data variable, as we all know, is world. I want an x value and I also want a y value. So now barplot function has understood that my data is world and what columns of this world are we taking on x-axis? If my question is which region has the highest literacy? So I'm asking computations to be done on literacy. So literacy will become my, exactly, region on x-axis and literacy on y-axis. So if you want to remove this warning, just go in and type semicolon or plt.show. And you can see that my ticks are not showing up. So I'll just do plt.xticks over here. And rotation equals to 90. So my bar plots are now showing up. So if you had used bar plots from pandas, you would have got blue bars only. But this uses a palette of set 1 and you are getting colorful bars, which is good to visualize. So there are different color palettes available within seaborn for bar plots. Go check it out, the documentation. So which region has the highest literacy? By this figure, it's not that clear. So let me open up plt.grid to be true. And from the going from the grids, we can say that Baltics region has the highest literacy. So now I have given you two questions as homework. Your task is to perform, is to plot a line chart, and the solution is not there in our solutions notebook. So interested people can send in their homework assignment notebooks to us. Okay, so this involves grouping because line plots exclusively take in the numerical data. So on X also you need numerical data for line plots, scatter plots, and also you need numerical data on your Y axis. But I'm asking a question, which region has the highest GDP? So region is categorical or a string type of data. So you have to use group by in this case and trick the line plot. So line plot can be plotted on a single variable. So line plots can either be plotted on single variables or even for bivariate plotting, they can be used. All right. So we can trick pandas and make that variable having indices as region and column values as GDPs. So in the solutions notebook, you can find the group by. So I have tricked pandas and I have grouped my world data frame with respect to region. And from this means that, suppose you're having a country like India, and then you have, are having a country like China. So all these reside in region Asia. So now let's come to the last section, which is the multivariate plotting. That is multiple variables related to multiple other variables. This is what is meant by correlation. So we'll just do world.porr. So population is related to population 100% and hence the value is 1. But area in square miles is related to population as 0.46. So as the area increases, so increases the population and they have a correlation of 0.5. You are analyzing a number of variables with respect to other variables. You are developing a correlation between them. So these are the insights that we can get. But this is very difficult to understand because it's all in a tabular format and you all have to go scroll from left to right again and again. So what we can do is visualize this. I've already have the code in the starter template as well. What I've done is I've set the axis because this is a two-dimensional data we are using, multivariate. So I have stored these axes, plt.axes, which is the plural for axes being 0 and 1. So I'm storing it in the variable ax and then running sns.heatmap because this heat map is a categorized plot of seaborn only. So it will show up in the seaborn library. So sns.heatmap, I've given the data as world, but now I've realized that not all of my columns in the world data frame. So I have run world.iloc, that is get me the index locations, and index locations takes in these two indices. Colon stands for all rows, that is give me all rows, but give me columns starting from the index 2 till the end. And then do a correlation on them. I could have done world.correlation, but those three rows of undesirable data would have popped up. So I deliberately removed that. I've done annotation to be true because I want to see values in each box. So suppose population and population is having a value of 1. So I want to see that on that box. So I've kept the annotation to be true. And now I've observed that these decimal values are pretty large, 5 or 6 in number. So it's okay to have just 2 decimal places. So I've set FMT to be 0.2F. That is just give me 2 decimal places. And then I have set a color map. So there is a whole lot of color maps for heat maps. Go check out the documentation. What I liked is cool warm. That is blue for my cool colors that are negatively correlated and warm that is red for those variables which are positively correlated. And now I have set my axes to be axes and stored in the variable ax. So these are the values required to form heat map. Again, I've set the title, and to remove all those arrays being generated, I've set plt.show. That is, show me only the plot, nothing else. So when I run the cell, I can see that indeed I've got cool colors which are negatively correlated and warm colors that are positively correlated. So I think everyone has now understood how we deal with a heat map, how we plot it, and how we explore the data. So now I would like you all to subscribe to our YouTube channel if you're interested for more videos like this. And also please subscribe to our Facebook page, and we'll add you in our WhatsApp group also. And thank you for joining us.